Hello, my beloved viewers. It's my hope that you are doing well. Welcome to our today's class. It's our first lesson on the ninth topic of formed work, which is called sound. So as usual, let me commence by giving you the quote of the day, which states that it's not enough to be a good student in school. You also need to be a good student of life in order for you to achieve your dreams. So as it is our norm, we shall discuss that quote at the end of our class today. So today we are looking at sounds, but even before I talk of sound, let's remind ourselves of energy, because sound is just one of the forms of energy. So from the form one topic, which was called heat transfer, we did define energy as simply the ability to do work. Then energy usually can take different forms. So the different forms of energy, we can have heat energy, we can have electrical energy, we can have light energy, then we can also have the sound energy. So sound is just one of the forms of energy. So having defined energy, let's now define sound. So sound is defined as a form of energy produced by vibrating bodies. A form of energy produced by vibrating bodies. Then remember, when we were looking at waves one, we did give the two main categories of waves. We did categorize waves as being electromagnetic and also being mechanical, whereby we said that electromagnetic waves are those that will not require material medium for transmission, or they are the waves that do not require any material medium for transmission. But we also said that mechanical waves are those that will always require a material medium for transmission. So that means mechanical waves cannot be transmitted unless there is a material medium, for example, air. So we did categorize sound as an example of longitudinal waves. Remember, under mechanical waves, we talked of transverse and also the longitudinal wave, whereby we said that longitudinal waves are those waves in which the transmission of the or the vibration of the wave particles will always be parallel to the direction of wave motion. So under longitudinal wave, we gave sound as an example. So in short, sound is a longitudinal wave, meaning that for sound waves, we expect the vibration of the wave particles to be parallel to the direction of wave motion. Now, sound wave being a longitudinal wave, there is what we call the audibility range, that is for longitudinal waves. So that means that for any longitudinal wave to be detected, it must fall within a certain threshold or some certain limits. So for sound to be heard, it must be between 20 hertz. Its frequency must fall between the 20 hertz or the 20 kilohertz. So when we talk of a kilohertz, we simply mean 1,000 hertz, because 1,000 hertz is equals to 1 kilohertz. So when I talk of 20 kilohertz, I simply mean 20,000 hertz. So for the audibility range for longitudinal waves, or in this case for sound, so that means for any form of sound to be detected by the ear, that is, be it a human ear or any other maybe type of animal's ear, then that particular sound or that particular longitudinal wave must fall between this particular frequency. So the wave, that is the sound wave, for the sound wave to be detected even by the human ear, it must fall between 20 hertz, that is, its frequency must fall between 20 hertz or 20,000 hertz. So that means that if you have a sound that has a frequency of less than 20 hertz, such a sound will not be detected by the ear. Then also, if you have a sound that is above 20,000 hertz, then such a sound will also not be clearly detected by the ear, because that will just be excess noise. It will be excess noise. So having said that sound is a longitudinal wave, let's look at the various sources of sound. That is, where is this particular sound emanating from, or where is the sound coming from? So sound can be obtained from various sources. Let's start by looking at the first one, and the first source of sound is what we are calling vibrating wooden strip. So the wooden strip can be a half a meter rule, such as the one that we have here. So you simply clamp the meter rule or on one end, or you fix it on one end, then you leave the other end being what? Flexible. So when a thin meter rule or when a thin strip of wood is clamped at one end in a vise, that is, and is struck sharply. So we strike this other end sharply. The free end, that is this particular free end here, is observed to vibrate. That is, it will vibrate to upper position, that is at this particular end, then it also vibrates to the lower position, that is at this particular end. So you simply clamp your half meter rule or any other thin wooden material, then you clamp it on one end, you leave one end being free, then you strike sharply, you sharply strike the other end which is free. So the end will be observed to vibrate to and fro, to and fro. So remember, as this particular half meter rule vibrates, there is air around it. There is air around it. So when the striking of this particular meter rule sets it into vibration, so as it vibrates, it also causes the air that is surrounding it to vibrate. And remember, whenever air around a certain material is set into vibration, then a sound is always going to be transmitted. So we are saying that when immediately you strike the object, actually a sound is produced. But for that sound to be transmitted, that is from this particular object where it was hit to your ear, there must be a medium, for example, air. So when the object is struck, it produces sound, but because there is air around it, that air, the air also is set into vibration, forming regions of what? Compressions and rarefaction. So though when those compressions and rarefactions reach your ear, they are now detected as what? Sound. Then the other source of sound is what we are calling a vibrating wire. We can have a vibrating wire. So you simply arrange the apparatus as shown here. So when a wire, that is when a wire is tightly tied on two pegs that have been fixed on a wooden box. So this is our wooden box, this is our peg. So you simply fix a wire, you tightly fix a wire on two pegs that have been fixed on a wooden box. That is as shown in this particular diagram. Then after doing that, you simply pluck this particular wire at the middle. So you pluck it, or you simply strike it at the middle. So you pluck it at its middle point. So when it is plucked at the midpoint, the wire will be observed to vibrate. So it will be vibrating up and down, that is to and fro. So remember, as the wire vibrates, it also causes. So the purpose of the wooden box in this particular case is simply to trap some air. So the wooden box simply traps some air, such that when this wire is vibrating, the pegs passes the vibration into this particular wooden box. So the air that is trapped within the wooden box is also set into vibration. So remember, when an object is set into vibration, it produces sound. But when that sound causes also, when the vibrating object causes the air that is trapped in between it, or also the air that is adjacent to this particular vibrating wire, when that air is set into vibrations, it produces what we call compressions and rarefactions, because we said compression and rarefactions will always define a longitudinal waves. So when those compressions and rarefactions reach your ear, that is what your ear detects as sound. That is what is detected as sound. So simply, the purpose of the wooden box is to trap some air, such that when that air is set into vibration, then the transmission of sound to your ear becomes effective. But remember, even without air, sound will still be produced. It will be produced, only that it won't be transmitted. So later on we'll see that for transmission of sound to occur, there must be a material medium. But for the production of sound to take place, you only need to set the object into a vibration. The other application or the other source of sound is what we call a vibrating drum, a vibrating drum. So drums are always made in such a way that they have some hollow part, they have some hollow regions. So one of the ends could be left free, or there could be some small holes along the skin of that particular drum to allow some air to enter it so that it can be trapped. So if it is hollow or if it is open on one end, the air is always getting to jet in or to enter in this particular hollow part of the drum, such that when this hand is used to strike the drum, or maybe if you are using a stick, so the hand is moving up and down. So as the hand moves down, it strikes this particular drum. And remember, we said that whenever an object is struck, it will always be set into vibration. And whenever an object is set into vibration, sound is going to be produced. But that sound cannot be transmitted without a material medium. So that's why a hollow region is always left, so that air can be occupy that particular space to act as the medium of transmission. So when the drum is struck by the hand, a sound is produced. Then, because the air is trapped between this particular drum, remember that air is, as the drum is struck, the air is also set into vibration. So when the air is set into vibration, it will always form regions of high pressure, that is the comprehensions, and regions of low pressure, that is the rarefactions. So when air is set, when the drum is hit, the drum is set into vibration. As the drum vibrates up and down, it also sets the air in between it into vibration. So when the air is set into vibration, it forms compressions and rarefactions. So when the compressions and rarefactions travel to your ear, that is what is detected as sound having been produced. So in summary, simply you hit the drum. When the drum is heated, the object, that is the drum, is set into vibration, therefore a sound is produced. Then the purpose of the air is simply to transmit the sound. So remember, the fewer or the lower the amount of air present, the lower the sound that will reach your ear, because the more the amount of air present, the faster that particular sound is going to be transmitted. Otherwise, if there is no air, when you hit the drum will produce the sound, but the sound will not get to your ear because there is no material medium such as air. The other source of sound is what we are calling a turning fork. So a turning fork usually has these particular ends that we usually call them the prongs. So this is one prong, this is also another prong. So the prongs of a turning fork are always made to vibrate by striking them against a hard surface. So when you strike these particular prongs, they will always be set into vibrations. So the sound produced can be heard more clearly, that is when the stem of the fork is fixed tightly on a hollow box or a bench, that is as shown in this particular diagram. So we fix the base of this particular turning fork onto a hollow box. So remember, we are using a hollow box because it has some space, and we know that in physics, when we have some space, there is always air in that particular region. So the box is hollow, so that we mount this particular vibrating fork on a hollow box, because the hollow box has trapped some air which will be set into vibration so that it can transmit that particular sound to our ear. So when the prongs of this particular turning fork are hit by an object, they start to vibrate. So as they vibrate, they set the air around them into vibration. They also set this particular stem, as it vibrates, it also sets the air that is trapped within this particular hollow box into vibration. So when the air, that is when the object is struck, a sound is produced. Then the striking of that particular object also causes the air around it to be set into vibration, and also the air in that particular hollow box to be set into vibration. And we have said that when the air is set into vibration, it always forms regions of compressions and rarefactions. That is regions of high pressure, that is the compressions, and regions of low pressure, which are the rarefactions. So when these particular compressions and rarefactions travel to your ear, or they get to an animal's ear, these particular compressions and rarefactions are what is detected as sound. And you have said that air is an important medium for propagating or transmitting that particular sound. And you have said that whenever there is no material medium, the sound will be produced, but you won't hear anything because there will be no a medium for transmitting that particular sound to your ear. Then it is also important to know that a turning fork of higher frequency when struck vibrates faster than the one of lower frequency, therefore producing sound of a higher note. So if you want to produce a sound of a higher note, you simply use a turning fork which has a higher frequency, because that which has a higher frequency, that is when it is struck, it will always be vibrating faster. Then when it vibrates faster, fast sounds are also produced, or louder sounds are also produced. So when the sound is produced, or when the prongs are set into vibration, they set the air around it also into vibration. Therefore, when air is vibrating, it usually forms compressions and rarefactions. Then these rarefactions, remember it is a longitudinal waves, huh? So there are compressions and rarefactions when they reach the human ear, that is what is detected as sound. The other source of sound is what we are calling a vibrating air column. So to obtain this, you simply fill a test tube with some liquid, for example water, maybe up to halfway. Then of course you leave the other region. The other region which is empty, we know that in physics, that region we shall always be having air occupying it, unless we are told maybe it is a vacuum. So suppose that this is my mouth, then I'm blowing air across the mouth of this particular test tube. So if air is blown across the mouth of a test tube, that is as shown in this particular diagram here, what will happen is that the air that is between this region, that is the air that is in color pink, remember the water is in color blue, then this particular region will be occupied by air. So when air is blown across the mouth of this particular test tube, the air that is trapped in this particular region, that is the region between the surface of water and the top end of the test tube. So when air is blown across this particular test tube, this particular air that is trapped between the water and the at the top of the test tube will be set into vibration. So when the air is set into vibration, it produces regions of what? High pressure, that is compressions, and regions of low pressure, that is rarefaction. So these compressions and rarefactions, when they get these compressions and rarefactions are what is detected by the human ear as the sound having been produced. Then if you also want to obtain, so the sound is produced because the column of air in the test tube is simply vibrating, because if it vibrates, it produces compressions and rarefactions which are detected by the human ear as the sound. So sounds of different frequencies can also be produced. So they are produced with different liquid levels, that is by changing the level of the column of air which is vibrating. For example, if you want to obtain the sound of different frequencies, maybe of higher frequencies and of low frequencies, you simply change the level of this particular water, such that when you fill more water, maybe if the water is at this particular region, it means now the space left to be occupied by air is minimal. So that will change the air column. Remember, the air column is the region from the top end of the test tube to the level of the water. So this distance here, or this region here, is what we are calling the air column, or the height from here up to the top end of the water. So if you want to obtain sounds of different frequencies, you simply vary the length of the air column, because if you fill water maybe up to this particular region, you are reducing the amount of air that is trapped in that particular region. If you reduce the amount of water, that will mean that more air, you are increasing the region of what? Air column. So if you want to obtain sounds of different frequencies, you simply vary the air column. Another application is the voice box, or what we are calling the larynx, that is which is found in the human body. So the human voice box contains vocal cords which vibrate to produce sound. So even the process by which you are getting the sound that I'm producing here is because I have a voice box which contains what we are calling the vocal cords within my the voice box. Remember, the voice box is always, in human beings, it is always located on the neck. It is on your neck. It is located on your neck. So that particular voice box, it has what we are calling the vocal cords, which tend to trap some air. Remember, as you breathe in and as you breathe out, some of the air will be trapped in this particular voice box, such that when that particular air is set into vibration, or when the vocal cords, when the human box contains, that is, when the vocal cords start to vibrate, they set that particular air that is trapped in between it to into vibration. And remember, when the vocal cords are set into vibration, a sound is produced, because the vocal cords in this particular case are representing our body or our object which has been struck. So when the vocal cords start vibrating, they produce sound. But because there is air that is trapped between that particular the vocal cords, that particular air is what is responsible for the transmission of that particular sound, such that when the vocal cords are set into vibration, the air that is trapped between the voice box, it is also set into vibration. As the air vibrates, it produces regions of compressions and rarefactions. And remember, the compressions and rarefactions are the ones that are detected by the human ear as sound. Another source of sound is the loudspeaker. Remember, we did look at the working of the loudspeaker in a topic called magnetic effect of an electric current. So maybe in case you are interested in knowing how a loudspeaker works, you can just revisit that particular lesson, that of course on this same channel, that is the magnetic effect of an electric current. So we did say that a loudspeaker usually has what we call a diaphragm. Then a diaphragm, it is usually made in a cylindrical manner such that it can trap some air. So the air that it traps, remember, as the sound waves, that is, as the electrical sound wave which has been converted into electrical energy, as it comes into what we are calling the diaphragm of the loudspeaker, the diaphragm is always going to vibrate. It will be set into vibration. As the diaphragm vibrates, it produces sound. But because it has trapped some air in between it, it means as it will be vibrating, it will produce sound. But the air that is trapped into it, as the diaphragm vibrates, also the air that it has trapped, it is also set into vibration. And as the air vibrates, it produces compressions and rarefactions, which are detected by the human ear as the sound. Even for the young boys, when you have maybe your radio and you want a louder voice, you usually take your speaker into a hollow region. For example, you can place the speaker into a port. Remember, a port usually traps a lot of air. Then that particular air, as the diaphragm of your speaker will be vibrating, it will produce sound. Then, because the port has trapped a lot of air, that air will also be set into vibration. Therefore, a louder sound will be produced. So remember, because the port has trapped a lot of air, that is what will cause a louder sound to be produced. Because that large amount of air will also be set into vibration, producing more regions of compressions and rarefactions, which are detected by the human ear as sound. So if there is fewer air, low regions of compressions and rarefactions will be formed. Therefore, a less louder sound will be heard. Then also telephone membranes, they also work on the same principle. Remember, a telephone usually has what we call the earpiece and the mouthpiece. So the earpiece usually also has a diaphragm. So as the electrical waves come into the diaphragm of the earpiece, the diaphragm of the earpiece starts vibrating. Then as it vibrates, it produces sound, because we said that sound is produced whenever an object is set into vibration. But because there is air around it, the diaphragm, as it vibrates, it also causes the air around it to be set into vibration. Then as the air vibrates, of course, it produces regions of compressions and rarefactions, which are detected by the human ear as sound. Other applications, we have the air siren, we also have the cogwheel and the card. Next, we look at propagation of sound energy. And whenever we talk of propagation, the word propagation simply means to convey or to move, maybe from one region to another. So it is possible also to move or to propagate sound energy from one region to another. So let's look at propagation of sound in various states of matter. So we know that from particulate nature of matter, that is a lesson that we also covered in this particular channel, we did say that matter is anything that has mass and that has weight and can occupy space, or has mass and can occupy space. Then we did say that we have three states of matter, that is the solid, liquid and gas. So in this case, our concern is the propagation of sound energy in these particular states of matter. So we have said that, remember, when particles, that is sound energy, that is sound is produced when particles of a given object are set into vibration. For example, in solids, we know that within that particular solid, we have particles which are always, when this particular solid or this particular material is struck, the particles within this particular solid will start vibrating, but at fixed position. They will start vibrating at fixed position. So when the solid is struck, or when it is struck by an object, the particle starts vibrating at fixed position. So as the particles vibrate, they produce what? As the particles vibrate, they produce sound. But that particular sound cannot be transmitted without any material medium. So for example, if this is the particle that is struck, because it will start vibrating at a fixed position and it is very close to the neighboring particles, it means it will transfer that particular sound energy to the next particle, that is the neighboring particle. This particle also starts vibrating, it transfers energy to the next particle. This particle also starts vibrating, transfers energy to the next particle, until that particular sound energy transfers from this particle to the farthest particle. So we are saying that sound energy will always be transmitted faster in solid. So the reason is simply because that in solid, the particles are close together. That is, the particles are closely packed together. Therefore, when one particle is set into vibration, it vibrates, then it transfers the energy to the nearest particle or to the next particle, and so on and so forth. Then sound transmission or sound propagation will always be slow in liquids, that is slow as compared to solids. So sound propagation is fastest in solids, followed by liquid, then slowest in gases. So sound propagation in liquids will be slow, because in liquids, the transmission of sound energy will be slow because the particles are slightly far apart from each other, such that if this is the particle that is struck in that particular liquid, it will take a longer time for this particle to transfer that energy to the nearest particle, for example, this particle here. So remember, as the particle travels a longer distance, it also loses the energy or the sound energy in the process. So if, like in solids, whereby the particles were closer to each other, such that the particle has the ability or is in a position to transfer more than 90% of its energy to the next particle because they are closer to each other. But in liquids, because the particles are slightly far away from each other, it means that as this particle starts to vibrate, as it looks to transfer the energy to the next particle, some of the energy will be lost in that particular case, and therefore most of the energy will not reach the next particles. That is what makes sound transmission in liquids to be slow, because the particles are slightly far apart from each other. Now, sound transmission or sound propagation is slowest in gases. The reason is simple. In gases, the particles are further away from each other. Therefore, when you hit one of the particles, the probability of this particle reaching the next particle, that is to transmit energy, is almost zero. The probability of one particle transmitting the energy to the next particle is very, very low. So that's why gases will always, transmission of sound energy in gases will be slowest. Even when you just take a simple stick, then try to hit it on a table, you will hear that the sound produced is louder. You take the same stick using the same amount of energy, then you hit that stick in water, you'll hear that the sound produced is somehow slower. That is, it is not as loud as the sound that was produced when you hit the table. Then you take the same stick, then you hit in air, you realize that the sound produced is very minimal, very, very less loud. So that again demonstrates to you that transmission of sound in gases is slower, followed by a transmission, but the transmission of sound energy is fastest in solid, simply because in solids the particles are fixed together, therefore their probability of transferring energy from one particle to the next is high, followed by liquids, whereby sound energy transmission in liquids is slow because the particles are far away from each other. Therefore, the probability of one particle transmitting the energy to the next particle is also low. But sound transmission in gases is very, very low because the particles are farther away from each other. Therefore, the probability of one particle which is struck transferring energy to the next particle is very, very low. In fact, almost negligible. But in the region where we have no gas, that is in a vacuum, sound will totally not be transmitted. Sound will not be transmitted because there will be no material medium. So clearly we are seeing that there must be a material medium, for example air, for sound to be transmitted. But do not confuse with the production of sound. Producing sound, we only need a material to be set into vibration, regardless of whether we have a medium or not. But for sound propagation, there must be a material medium. So that means it is possible that when you hit an object in a vacuum, a sound will be produced because the material will be set into vibration. But the sound won't be transmitted to your ear because there is no material medium, for example, air, to transmit that particular sound. So let's look at an experiment to verify or to ascertain that indeed sound cannot be transmitted in a vacuum. So in this particular experiment, of course, the apparatus required, we need an electric circuit. So of course, this is a switch. This is a battery, simply a combination of cells. We have a rubber bank, which simply helps us to trap the air so that it does not leave this particular belly jar. Then we have a vibrating hammer. Of course, the hammer will only vibrate when the circuit is complete. We have a rubber cord. We have a flexible wire, we have a vacuum, we have a gong, then we also have a hammer and of course a glass plate also to secure our air. Then we have a vacuum pump. So a vacuum pump will just help us to obtain a vacuum or a region without air. So initially, that is when air is still trapped in this particular belly jar, that is when we have not opened our vacuum pump. So when the circuit is complete, of course, the electric bell, that is, will be working such that the hammer will be vibrating in such a case that it is hitting the gong. Remember, if you want to understand maybe the working of an electric bell, just revisit our previous lesson on which was in on magnetic effect of an electric current. We actually explained how an electric bell works. So when the circuit is complete, we expect the hammer, that is the electric bell, to produce some sound. That is, the hammer will start vibrating, in the process hitting the gong. So remember, gong is a solid or it is a material. And remember we said that whenever a material is set into vibration, a sound will be produced. So when the hammer, when the circuit is complete, the hammer starts vibrating, hitting the gong, hence producing sound. But now, our aim here is to look at the propagation or the transmission of what? Sound energy. Our aim is not about the production of what? Sound energy. So when the vibrating hammer hits the gong, a sound will be produced. So when initially, when the air is still trapped in this particular belly jar, you'll actually hear the sound of the gong, or you'll hear the sound of an electric bell. That is, you'll hear, you'll see the hammer vibrating, and you'll also hear the sound. That is when the hammer hits the gong. That is when the air is still trapped in this particular belly jar. So the reason why you will hear that sound is because there is air that is trapped in that particular belly jar. And remember, air is the material medium which is responsible for the transmission or the propagation of that particular sound. So we have said earlier that when the gong is set into vibration, actually it will cause the air which is trapped in this particular belly jar also to start vibrating. So as the gong vibrates, it produces sound. Then it also, as the gong also vibrates, it also sets the air around it into vibration. Then when the air is set into vibration, it produces regions of what? Compressions and rarefactions. Then when these regions of compressions and rarefaction gets to the human ear, that is what is detected as sound. So that means if there was no sound actually, if there was no air or the material medium, the sound will be produced, but you won't hear it because there will be no material medium to transmit it. Now, when we open or when we switch on our vacuum pump such that it sucks all the air from this particular belly jar, it is observed that the gong or the vibrating hammer continues vibrating, which means sound continues to be produced, although you won't hear any sound. So you will not hear any sound because there is no material medium. So when all air is sucked out of this particular belly jar, a sound will be produced, but you won't hear it. The reason being, there is no material medium to transmit it into your ear. So when this particular region is a vacuum, that is when we have sucked all the air from it, a sound will be produced, but your ear will not detect any sound, simply because a material medium is not present. So that's simply showing that a sound cannot travel in a vacuum or in a region without a material medium. Now, when the air that was taken by to the vacuum pump is restored into the belly jar, it is observed that sound is restored. The sound will be heard. That is when the air is taken back. So that simply ascertains that there can be no transmission of sound without what? A material medium. So we've come to the end of our class today, but we need to discuss the quote of the day. The quote of the day stated that it's not enough to be a good student in school. You also need to be a good student of life in order for you to achieve your dreams. So the quote is simply reminding us that a good academic performance does not guarantee you a good life. Just in the same way, a poor academic performance does not guarantee you a miserable life. So if you perform well in academics, do not feel complacent. Instead, stay humble and suppress your pride, because there is still more work to be done in order for you to achieve your dreams. Conversely, if you perform poorly in academics, do not give up, because you still have a chance to succeed in life by becoming a good student of life. So what do I mean by a good student of life? So a good student of life has the following characteristics. So a good student of life in this scenario means accepting to be corrected, respecting everyone irrespective of their status, learning from your own and from other people's mistakes, using the little you have to serve others, improving your skill sets, improving your mental strength by reading and watching inspirational content, solving problems instead of just complaining and looking for excuses, surrounding yourself with the right company, removing energy drainers from your inner circle, and also taking risks and being willing to adapt to various situations. Thank you very much for accompanying me until the end of this particular lesson. If you've not subscribed, kindly do so. If you have enjoyed the lesson, just hit that particular like. Then also remember to turn on the notification bell so that whenever I upload a new video, you'll be the first person to get a notification. Also, if you know anyone that you honestly think could benefit from this channel, kindly do me an act of kindness by sharing this channel to them. Thank you very much. Until next time.